We're glad you're here today worshiping with us at Unity Christian Church. We're continuing in our series on the Ten Commandments. You say, well, how long is this series going to go? Well, there's 10 of them. We're on number 8, so we're almost through them, okay? You do the math because you know I can't, okay? We are glad you're here and as we continue. And so why don't you stand right now, and Jason and Heather are going to lead us in a time of singing and worship.
Good morning, everyone.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. Plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. Launch me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. This is the day that You have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in Your name, and now Your joy awaits my praise. I give thanks. I give thanks for all You have done, and I will sing of Your mercy and Your love. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. When I was down, You brought me out and set my feet on higher ground. So here I stand, You are my God, Your faithfulness my solid rock. I give thanks for all You have done, and I will sing of Your mercy and Your love. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all You have done. I won't forget all the battles You have won. Your love is unfailing. Lord, I am grateful. Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who's slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who's slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who's slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amen. Please be seated.
There are a whole lot of people who have a whole lot of opinions about the Ten Commandments. But the reality is, these Ten Commandments that we've been studying and will finish in a few weeks are an expression of God's love for us. Now, they're not some antiquated, outdated, ancient principles of the past, but they are as contemporary, more contemporary than today or tomorrow's newspaper for that matter. They're supernatural principles that have withstood the test of time. From the time they were given, just about every justice legal system since this time have been foundational, or the Ten Commandments have been foundational to that law and to that justice. So it's not like they're outdated. It's not like they're old covenant versus new covenant. These are timeless, supernatural principles established by God in order to maintain a just society. And the Ten Commandments specifically say, not once, but 10 times, there are things you shall not do. Kind of say, here's the line, don't cross this line. That's what the Ten Commandments are all about. The point is that there are limits to human conduct. There are lines that you can cross or could cross. And God says, here's the line in the sand, don't cross this line. Now, what has happened with a lot of people, we kind of always figure this out. When somebody says, here's a do not, don't do this, we kind of say, okay, where's the gray area? How close can I get to doing this without violating or crossing that particular line? Well, the Ten Commandments are pretty clear. There are things you cannot do, things you should not do, and the reality is if you do them, you will suffer the consequences. There are consequences for violating this, and every legal system that follows the Ten Commandments has consequences in place for that particular violation. Now, here's the deal. There are a lot of people who say, man, that's a harsh God. Well, not at all. Again, these are expressions of God's love, but they are the expressions rules, if you will, of a just and gracious God instructing us, here's the way you can live your best life by following these. This is how you can have a rich, full, and complete life with these in place in your life. And that brings us to the eighth commandment that says, you shall not steal. According to the FBI and their Unified Crime Report, UCR, 2019 is the latest totals I could find. In 2019, there were 5,086,096 incidents of theft or larceny. 5 million in 1 year. That's a whole lot of stealing going on. I don't care who you are. They actually were able, based on their crime reports. Now, those are the ones that were reported, okay? Just so you, and it doesn't include like pickpocketing, or it doesn't include embezzlement or white collar crime or check fraud or forgery. That's just in theft or larceny, okay? They affixed a value to each one of those. The average cost or the average value of every theft was $1,162. So there are 5 million of those instances in 2019 at an average cost of $1,100 each. Okay, you do the math on that one. You know, that's all. That's a whole lot of grand larceny taking place. And if you've ever had anything stolen from you, you know exactly what that feels like. The frustration and the violation of somebody stealing something that belongs to you. It all comes with that experience. Our house, I would say it was broken into, but it really wasn't broken into. We left the garage door open one Sunday after church. That was shortly after I moved to California, you know, and I just assume everybody in California was like everybody in Kentucky, you know. I didn't even think of it. We'd gone home from church. We backed the car out of the garage. I said, oh, we're not going to be going long. Left the garage door open. And they walked away with our VCR, my son's trombone, and the most prized possession, my golf clubs. Yeah.
You've heard about people that get stomping mad. I don't get stomping mad very often, but sometimes I do. And that was one of those days. I came home and we didn't, you know, the garage door was still open. So I pull up, you know, didn't think, oh, I left the garage door open, you know, and went in and there wasn't any indication of theft until we got ready to play the VCR on something. By the way, those of you, a VCR was an old machine that you'd put VHS tapes in, you know. You could actually record. Okay, never mind. But if you've had something stolen, you know what I'm talking about. There's this sense of offense and violation that, wow, they took something that belonged to me. And whether it was hard-earned money, whether it was an irreplaceable keepsake, or maybe even some expensive necessity like golf clubs, we feel angry and offended. It's not that we worship what we own, you know. It's not like, oh man, you know, or that we equate our own personal value and worth to what we own and possess. It's simply that deep-seated need in every one of us to protect our personal property. And for somebody to take something that's not theirs, that belongs to me, there's this, you know, it offends. Because here's the thing, there's this kind of unwritten agreement that most of us in this room, we agree that we're not going to steal somebody else's stuff, and we assume that they also are in agreement that they're not going to steal ours. There's this unwritten agreement that we have, covenant that we have with others. Don't steal. I won't steal your stuff, don't you steal mine. That doesn't always apply, and when it doesn't, and when that's violated, we're offended and angry, and rightly so. Because here's the thing, it angers God as well. And that's why he wrote the eighth commandment, you shall not steal. Now, I'm pretty convinced that there's nobody in this room and maybe watching online. I feel pretty sure that none of you here today have robbed a bank. You know, I like... Not like you're going to rob a bank, you know, not like you've mugged somebody and taken their purse or their wallet. Not like you've broken into a home to steal something or ever held up a Circle K, okay? I'm just making that assumption about our crowd here today. And if any of you need to confess something after the service, I'll be down front, you know. So we get the big picture when it comes to theft and robbery, right? You know, we kind of say, yeah, well, I've never done anything like that. So in order for us to really understand this commandment, you shall not steal, we need to dig a little deeper. And some of you are going, I was afraid you were going to say that. Into this commandment, you shall not steal. Let's talk about the four ways we can and maybe do steal. That we think, well, that doesn't apply. Yeah. So let's dig a little deeper in this eighth commandment. How can we steal? How do we steal? Well, first of all, we deceive. We deceive. Deceive means a concealment or a perversion of the truth in order to mislead. That's deception. The Proverbs writer says, a fortune made by a lying tongue is a fleeting vapor and a deadly snare. Let me read that again. A fortune made by a lying tongue is a fleeting vapor and a deadly snare. Okay? He's talking about deception. When a repair person makes an unnecessary repair, you know, and or bills you for other things that weren't included, that's deception and that's stealing. Maybe when somebody skips over the fine print in the contract you're entering into, they say, yeah, that's just boilerplate stuff. You know, we can go on. And the fine print is usually what jumps up and bites you. That's deception and that's stealing. When you sell a vehicle of any kind, car, truck, any kind, and you don't tell all the problems that go along with that purchase to somebody, that's lying and then stealing on top of it. So you get two for the price of one. When you deceive, that's stealing. Lies, half-truths. You know, how many times have you said or heard somebody say, well, I didn't tell a lie, but I didn't tell the whole truth. I withheld some things. That's deception. And if you gain from that deception, that's what the eighth commandment covers, stealing. They might pass as slick sales process or procedures or pitches, but they're nothing more than sophisticated forms of stealing. I haven't been real truthful with what I'm about to sell you, you know, but you'll find out. So sooner or later, I'll go with the later and sell you this and make a whole lot of money of it, but, you know, money that it wasn't valued at. Stealing means to take something without permission. If you call in sick to your job and you're not, that's stealing. If you use false or deceptive advertising, that's stealing. There are a lot of things. See, somewhere along the line, our society, our culture, our world has slipped in to say, well, they're gray areas. Well, that's where the Ten Commandments, you know, there's no gray area. You either steal something or you don't, you know. And part of that is the deception we use in order to gain something for ourselves. A lot of things seem innocent, but when you deceive in order to take something that's not yours, the Eighth Commandment says you're stealing. So this idea of deception to gain fits right in this idea of you shall not steal. Because the Bible says when we steal by deception, we've forgotten God. That's what the Bible says, Ezekiel 22. The sovereign Lord says, you make unjust gain from your neighbors by extortion, and you have forgotten me, declares the sovereign Lord. So when we use deception for personal gain, to something, cash, possessions, articles, whatever it might be, that deception means that we've forgotten God. That's what the Bible says. Not only do we deceive, we defraud. We defraud. That means to cheat. You say, what's the difference? Well, you use deception to get one way. This, it's just fraudulent. You know, you basically, again, talk about lying, just to cheat somebody. Now, there was a time back in the Old Testament in the book of Amos when God uses the prophet Amos in order to try to correct Israel's evil and dark ways. And he's preaching and preaching. And as part of this process of cleansing the nation, Amos talks about how the Israelites were thinking during this particular time in their dark days. Amos 8:5, they decided, you know, during this period of time, they said, we can charge them more and give them less, and we can change the scales to cheat the people. See, that's, you know, and that's stealing, according to the Eighth Commandment. One of my favorite illustrations of defrauding comes from a 1936 Leslie Thatcher. Most people mistake it for Rockwell. It's not Leslie Thatcher. 1936 cover of the Saturday Evening Post. See what's going on there? He's weighing, it looks like a chicken. He's weighing and he's pushing down to put a little more weight. She's on the other side of the scale pushing up, you know. Probably it all balances out. So, see, in our culture, society today, said, well, it kind of works, you know. It all balances out, so nobody's getting cheated there. Because that, we believe it's a gray area, you know. We've become far more sophisticated in what the Bible says is changing the scales in order to cheat someone. If you pad your expense account, if you're traveling for your company and you're padding your expense account, that's stealing. If you're divorced and you refuse to pay your child support or alimony court ordered, that's stealing. If you get overpaid something, Charles Spurgeon, the great preacher, tells the story that he was holding a revival in London, and he got on the bus in order to get to where he was going, and the bus driver, or whatever it was, trolley, anyway, gave him change back, but the guy gave him too much change back, and Spurgeon went to sit down and looked, and before he got off at his stop, he handed the overcharge, you know, the money he got over, handed it back, said, you gave me too much change back. And he goes, I know, I was at your services last night and you preached on this very thing, and I wanted to see if you practice what you preached. See, if you get overpayment on something, a refund check that was too much, you get packages sent to you and you didn't order it, or you get more than you got than you ordered, and you know, anytime you keep any of that, that's stealing, that's defrauding, and it's a form of stealing. If you arrive late on the job and you take extra long breaks and then leave early, that's stealing. If you take supplies from your employer, it's stealing. There's no justification. You say, well, I've worked hard a long time for this company. It's okay for me if I can sneak a ream of paper out in my in my briefcase, or I can, this is overrun on the product. I can take that out. You see, there's no justification. We might say, well, the divorce wasn't my fault, so, you know, finders keepers, I'm not paying alimony or child support. I didn't make this happen. There's no justification for violating the Eighth Commandment, regardless. You know, there isn't any. I love the old song. You know, Johnny Cash years ago did a song about a Cadillac, you know, and he got it one piece at a time. I love that song, you know. He left Kentucky, went up to the GM in Detroit, GM factory, Detroit, and he was on the Cadillac line, and he sure loved the Cadillac. So he said, I got it one piece at a time. And so he would sneak parts of that Cadillac out in his lunchbox every day. You know, and he talks about, you know, the transmission was a little hard to get, you know, but, you know, eventually he put it all together. You know, I got it one piece at a time, and it didn't cost me a dime. You'll know me when I come through your town. And then he goes, it's a 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60 Cadillac, you know. But I digress, right, you know. Yes and no. He got it one piece at a time, and then somebody, you know, actually built, I saw a picture of somebody actually built that Cadillac that he put together one piece at a time. It's a freaky looking thing now, I'm going to tell you. But at the end of it all, he had a Cadillac. See, here's the thing, you know, that's funny, that's a great song, you know. We wouldn't think about going out and stealing a car. We wouldn't give any thought to that. I don't think we would, you know. I'm going to boost that car, you know. We wouldn't do that. But there's something about taking it one piece at a time in the installment plan that said, well, that seems reasonable, because we have a limit, you know. If I were to steal a $50,000 car, that's one thing. You know, but if I were to just kind of take it one piece at a time, and we justify it, and you know, it's not like I stole a truckload of paper. I took it one ream at a time. There's no justification for violating the eighth commandment. The Bible says, do not defraud or rob your neighbor. Do not hold back the wages of a hired worker. The idea is all of that defrauding is stealing, and it's a violation of the eighth commandment. Employers, don't defraud your employees. James says, look, the wages you failed to pay the workers who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty. And then Paul goes on in Colossians 4. And let me just substitute here. Masters or employers, provide your slaves or your employees with what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. We defraud. Third way we steal is we default. We default. Defaulting is simply failing to meet the obligation of payment, failing to meet financial obligations. See, we live in a bankruptcy crazy world, you know. For the longest time, and I haven't seen it so much, but there was a period of time when the bankruptcy laws were so lean and cloudy that anybody could file bankruptcy, and a lot of people were. You know, hey, their bankruptcy laws are kind of wide open now. You know, we can get to this point in our debt, and debt that we knowingly and willfully incurred. And so in order, we can default and file bankruptcy and get clear of all of this. Even if you haven't filed bankruptcy, a lot of people borrow money without intending to ever pay it back. Sometimes people borrow money knowing they have no ability to pay it back, and that creates a burden. That's what, when it talks about defaulting, the Bible, we call it, well, I've defaulted on my loan. No, you just stole that money. That's what that means. Paul told the Romans in Romans 13:8, let no debt remain outstanding. Psalm 37:21 says, the wicked borrow and do not repay. Simply stated, when we don't pay our bills, we're stealing. When we fail or refuse to pay debt that we willfully and knowledgeably incurred, that's stealing. And when we file bankruptcy simply to avoid the debt that we knowingly, willfully incurred, when we file bankruptcy in order not to pay that debt, that is defaulting. And the eighth commandment says, you shall not steal. Fourth, we delay. We deceive, we defraud, we default, and we delay. Look at this, Leviticus 19:13. The Bible says, don't take advantage of anyone. And let me just ask you, maybe, and maybe you do, maybe you don't. Maybe there's something in your garage, your barn, in your work shed, maybe even in your house, that may belong to somebody else. You may have borrowed it, you know, long-term borrowing. That's the way we think we avoid violating the eighth commandment. And I'm not so sure there's a time limit on what that looks like, but if you've borrowed something and you've forgotten that you borrowed it, and or you've forgotten that you loaned it, or you've had it so long you think it's yours anyway, that's delaying. Long-term borrowing is stealing. Regardless of your intent, well, I was going to give it back, I just forgot I had it. Well, so I mean, encourage you today, go home, go through your garage, go through your barn, go through your house, you know, and if you've got something there, you think, I don't ever remember buying that. Did I? Of course, then you may not remember who you borrowed it from. Okay, the way you get over that is you never use it again. If you don't remember... just put it away. You're not allowed to use it anymore, you know. Or I tell you what, if you want to ease your conscience, you know, just pay me $50 and it'll be yours. wait a minute. I'm kidding about that. No, never mind. This just opens up a whole... Okay, I got to move on. Okay. We delay. In the Bible, that long-term borrowing, it's really stealing, you know. So return something today. Why do we do that?
Why do we go through all those hoops in order to acquire something that's not ours and justify jumping through those hoops to default, delay, deceive, defraud? Why do we do that? Well, let me give you three quick reasons why we steal. Regardless of what you want to call it, we steal. One is greed. Paul wrote to Timothy, he said, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered far from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." Greed. Greed. That's what, you know, if I can figure out a way to make more or to have more, which is the broad definition of greed, I'll defraud, I'll delay, I'll deceive, I'll default, I'll do whatever it takes if it allows me to acquire more. Greed. Two, laziness. Why do we steal? Because we're just flat lazy. Why should I work if I can steal what I need? See, laziness. As much as we'd like to find shortcuts that would allow us to avoid work, for most of us, there are none. So we're just lazy. So we steal. We figure out ways to steal. And then third is pride. Somehow in our warped culture and in our warped sense of values today, we get a thrill out of conning people. You know, getting more value than something is worth because, you know, we sold them something and we made a really great pitch, but we didn't really tell them anything was wrong. When we get somebody to buy something for far more than it's worth, or we sell something for far more than it's worth, we take pride in that. You know, it's like we're... It shows my superior intelligence. If I can outsmart you and get you to pay more than what this what it's worth, or I can get you to sell it to me for less than what you know it to be worth. But when it comes to this idea of pride and stealing, it's not a matter of superior intellect, but it becomes a matter of inferior character. So that's why we steal. Some people, out of pride, will stoop at anything in order to make the deal and for them to gain from that. So, okay, that's why we do it, how we do it. How do I overcome? How can I obey the eighth commandment? Well, let me give you a couple of ways that the Bible says is honorable. First of all, work. You can avoid stealing by working. Paul wrote this in Ephesians. He said, "Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work." Hold it right there. Don't jump yet. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work. You see, Paul says the antidote to stealing is to get a job, to work so you don't have to steal anymore, which goes back to the idea of laziness being one of the causes we steal because we're not working. Paul says you want to obey the eighth commandment? If you've been stealing, steal no longer, go to work. Doing something useful, he goes on, with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. So Paul says, you don't want to steal? Then start working. But there's some qualifications in that. In Proverbs 13, the Bible says, "Wealth from gambling quickly disappears. Wealth from hard work grows." You know, if you're gambling away whatever money you have, then it goes pretty fast. But the idea, the proverb writer says, if you're working and it's consistent and you're working consistently, then that money will always grow because you're continuing to work and it's continuing to produce wealth. Again, in Proverbs, all hard work brings a profit, but mere talk leads only to poverty. Now, I honestly believe, and I'm not, let me just say it, there's no reason anybody should ever be out of work today. Everybody's hiring, you know. Everybody. We're not here at church, but but everybody else is, you know. That's how we obey the eighth commandment. We work. Many, if not most of you, have either worked and are retired, or you are continuing to work, regardless of a factory worker, farmer, teacher, whatever it is you do. And you're producing income that allows you to do what normal people do, which is to work in order to earn, to give, to save,
and spend. And when you stop, that's not all that undesirable of a process. We were kind of taught that from the almost day one in our lives, you know. And it's biblical. And you avoid the process of going out and to steal if you're working to provide. See, we can enjoy the knowledge that we labored diligently, we budgeted wisely, we spent wisely, and we acquired property and possessions to use personally or to give away according to the way God directs. I mean, it's just a long line of stuff. When you do what God says to do, there's satisfaction. And I heard a guy talking this week, you know, how important it is to get people back to work. Because it's more than just the financial benefit of working and being paid for the work you do. They've gone and said, you know, we are in an emotional, mental crisis in our nation today because of so many people out of work. There's no routine to their life. There's no income coming because they were either laid off and didn't go back to work, but they're not working now. And it was through this whole process of the value of simply working. Emotionally, physically, financially. It was amazing. I thought, there you go. That's all biblical. You know, Paul wrote this, when we were with you, we gave you this rule. And I'm sure you've heard this rule. My mom used to yell this at me all the time. Anyone who refuses to work should not eat. You know, I tell you, there have been a few times when I didn't do my part in chores, that it wasn't uncommon, you know, that I didn't get a plate set at my it was temporary. Mom making a point, you know. Sit down, and I didn't have a plate. I didn't get a plate. Did you work today? No. Well, there you go. Anyone doesn't work doesn't eat. That's what the Bible says. It was tough at our house now. I'd say it was temporary. She'd say, you'll work next time, won't you? And I thought, my thought was, well, not if you're going to feed me now. Score. Okay, he goes on to say, we hear that some people in your group refuse to work. They do nothing but busy themselves in other people's lives, you know. Paul said, "This we've told you this, you know. So there's biblical precedent to working, you know. So he says, work. He wrote Timothy, anyone who does not provide for their relatives and especially for their own household has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. The only way you can do that to take care of your family and relatives is to work. So he says, go work. You're worse than an unbeliever if you've got people in your family who have needs and you're not helping to meet those needs. So work is what. But it's not just about work. It's about honorable work. Look what he says, 4:28, anyone must work doing something useful with their own hands. Something useful. He's talking about honest, honorable, and productive work. Useful means that which is good in quality. That refers to a God-honoring employment or job or project. I think it goes without saying, although, I don't know, but the idea is we should never be involved in a job or a profession or a business or a project that asks us to compromise God's standard in our lives. Anything that dishonors him or violates his commandments, that's the kind of job we need to avoid. A job that might mislead or harm others in another way. Paul says that as we work, we should do work that honors God. This is what he says, Colossians 3. He says, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Who do you work for? Well, you might have a boss and you might work for a company, but the reality is what the Bible says is as a Christian, when you work, you're working for God. So that what you do honors him. In word or deed, make sure that your life honors him. And the third principle, when it comes to this idea of work, you work honorably, and you be generous. Really? Ephesians 4:28, we're to work, we're to do something useful, but then he says that we may have something to share with those in need. Do you realize that God gives us the ability to produce wealth in order for us to be generous? That's bottom line. When you work, he gives you the ability to share something with those in need. That's part of the process. That goes all the way back to Old Testament law. You know, farmers were to leave a certain corner of their field for people who didn't have. So they would always leave the corners of their fields for people to come and glean, or they weren't supposed to glean their fields completely so that those who did not have were able to walk the fields and glean what they could from those fields. See, God always had a provision plan. And one of those provision plans, or for those of us who have the ability to work, we have the opportunity to be generous as God supplies. Proverbs 11, one person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. Let me read that to you from the Living Bible. It says the same thing, but in a little more understandable way. It is possible to give away and become richer. It is also possible to hold on too tightly and lose everything. Yes, the liberal person shall be rich. By watering others, they water themselves. You say, well, okay, there are a lot of ways, you know, that I may have in my lifetime violated this command by deceiving or defrauding or defaulting or delaying. But according to Scripture, one of the best ways to overcome those tendencies and to obey the eighth commandment is to work so you don't steal, to work honorably, useful, and to be generous. The antidote to stealing. See, giving is just the opposite of stealing. When you're willing to, you're not bound by greed or pride or laziness because you've worked and now you have the ability to share with those in need. That's the biblical principle applied. This commandment boldly declares that we should only acquire what we have, possessions and wealth, through biblically acceptable means. And that's through work, working honestly, and through generosity, because part of that passage and part of the principle is you sow or you reap what you sow. So when you are generous with others, the Bible's promise, the principle is God will be generous to you. So you don't have to steal. When you work honorably, and you're generous with what God has already provided you with. We work diligently, we work honorably, and we're generous. Now, in a society where everything's in the gray, you know, and people get away with this and other people don't, and it's just, you know, we live in that world today. This is a stiff challenge for people in our world, in our culture, our society today. As it comes to doing business with others, dealing with people. But for those of us who follow Jesus Christ, those of us who follow the biblical principle and standard of what it means to work and not steal, there's a great generous reward when we obey the eighth commandment. That is a clear conscience when it comes to this idea of how we acquire wealth and possessions. There's a sense of freedom in the process that allows us to enjoy fully our property, our possessions that God has allowed us to acquire. The eighth commandment says, you shall not steal. Let's pray. Father, in our world, in our culture, it's so easy for us to get caught up in the mainstream of gray. I didn't lie, but I didn't tell the whole truth. All of that goes on, and maybe even in our own lives. So, Father, we repent. We ask you to forgive us for we've failed in that way, where we've acquired something through false means. Father, we want to live our lives, and your commandments give us the path in order to live our lives for your glory, to honor you by keeping these commands. And I just pray, God, in our dealings with people, in our desire to acquire, that we do it all in the framework of your word for your glory and our growth. In Jesus' name, amen. Each week we offer an invitation, whether the sermon is particularly evangelistic or not, or speaks to your heart. Maybe I've discovered that the Holy Spirit has a way of taking whatever message that is preached and touching somebody's heart or life. Maybe over the course of the time you've been coming or are here, you've been thinking about committing your life to Jesus Christ, confessing your faith in Him, being obedient in baptism. Maybe you've been thinking about becoming a part of our church family. I don't want to ever let too long a time pass without giving you an opportunity to respond to one of those calls in your life. So we're going to sing this song, and it's a good song. You know, make my life a sanctuary. Make my life a life that honors you, God. And one of the greatest ways you can honor Him is by committing your life to Him or becoming a part of a church family. So if either one of those thoughts or choices or decisions are on your mind today and you're ready to have that conversation and make that choice, I'm going to invite you to step out from where you are, make your way to the front as we stand and as we sing together.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Let's sing that again.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
You can be seated.
I'm going to introduce you to these folks in just a moment. But we come to this part of our service that we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made. And here's a beautiful thing. The body of Christ, unified all around the globe. And the one point of our unity is this time in our service. And so we remember the sacrifice Jesus made, and as a result of that, we who have given our lives to Him, we who have been covered by the blood of Christ, who have joined the body of Christ with our confession of faith and our baptism, weekly, around the globe, for the last 2,000 years and beyond, we've gathered as this church to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. And so today, we are no different here at Unity Christian. As we remember the sacrifice Jesus made on the cross in giving of His body for you and me, let's eat the wafer together in remembrance. And as we consider His shed blood, let's drink the cup together. Father, we do thank You. We thank You for this opportunity to just pause briefly this week. Today, on the first day of the week, this opportunity has a dual purpose. It allows us to remember the sacrifice You made for our sins. And Lord, we know there have probably been times in these past 7 days where we have failed You, maybe even in the area we've talked about. We claim that forgiveness through this act of communion and remembrance today. But also, Father, as we look ahead to the days before us, till we can come together again, we rest in your grace that your sacrifice on the cross has accomplished for us, that when you forgive our sins, it's not just our past sins, it's our present day sin, and the blood of Christ covers our sin in the days ahead. All of that comes in this brief moment that we've set aside to honor you, to remember, and to thank you for what you've done for us. Help us to share that good news with others in the days ahead. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thanks for joining us today online, our Unity Christian Church services. Each week, we premiere at 8 o'clock every Sunday, and we thank you for being a part of that. For more information about our church, you can go to unitychristianchurch.net, to our website, and find a connection to our services, as well as that additional information about how you can give and how you can connect with us further. God bless you. Have a great week, and be safe.